السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
The Almighty, the tendency to dedicate children in the Jamaat to the Waqf-e Noor scheme is growing. I receive letters from parents daily, and some days there are 20 to 25 letters in which parents are requesting their expectant child to be included in the Waqf-e Noor, i.e. life dedication scheme. Initially, when Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV, Rahimullah, started this scheme, it was only for a temporary period. But later he made it permanent, and the members of the community, particularly the mothers all around the world, responded to this call. Twelve to 13 years ago from today, when the Jamaat's attention was drawn to this scheme, the total number of Waqf-e Noor was over 28,000. However, by the grace of Allah the Almighty, the total number of Waqf-e Noor is now nearing 61,000, out of which over 36,000 are boys and the rest are girls. Thus, along with the passage of time, there is an increase in the number of those who wish to dedicate their children before their birth. However, the duties and responsibilities of the parents do not finish after having dedicated their children. In fact, they increase even more than before. Indeed, the responsibility of the upbringing of an Ahmadi child lies with the parents. And there is no doubt that the parents will desire the best for their child when it comes to their secular and also their religious education, providing that they are inclined towards religion themselves. But one should always bear in mind that every child of the Jamaat, and particularly a Waqf-e Noor child, is a trust that has been committed to the care of the parents by the Jamaat, and so it is incumbent upon them to provide them with proper training and make them valuable members of the Jamaat and the society in general.
لیکن بہتر طور پر
However, the upbringing and training of Waqfinen or children, and also their secular and religious education, and then to present them to the Jamaat in the best manner possible, becomes a responsibility in this respect also, because the parents make a pledge before the birth of the child that whatever is about to be born, whether the child is male or female, they will devote that child in the way of God Almighty and for the completion of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's ardent devotee's mission, which is the spread and propagation of the truth and the propagation of the teachings of Islam to all parts of the world. The mission, which is to draw the world's attention to fulfilling the dues of God Almighty, and the mission to fulfill the rights of one another by conveying the teachings of Islam to each and every person. Thus, this is no ordinary responsibility of the parents of Waqfin or children, and particularly of the mother who devotes her child before its birth while making a pledge with Allah the Almighty. And then by writing to the Khalifa of the time that they would like to include the child in the Waqfino scheme by making the same pledge with Allah the Almighty as did the mother of Hazrat Maryam, which is meaning, "My Lord, I have vowed to thee what is in my womb to be dedicated to thy service. I don't know whether it is a male or female, but whatever it is my desire and it's my prayer that may it be a servant of the faith. Fataqabbal minni," i.e., that accept this desire and prayer of mine. And then it states, "Innaka antas samiyul alim," i.e., "Thou alone art all hearing and all knowing. Thus hear my humble supplication, as you know that this prayer is from the heart." This is the wish of the mothers before dedicating the child, and indeed this should be the desire of every Ahmadi mother when she decides to present her child for the Waqfino scheme, and so too should be the case for the fathers. Therefore, when this prayer is made by the mother who wants to dedicate the life of her child in the Waqfino scheme, then she and the father must also be mindful of those responsibilities which fall upon them in order for the fulfillment of this pledge and for the acceptance of this prayer. Since the child is presented to the Waqfino scheme after the consent from both the mother and also the father, God Almighty has not simply preserved this prayer in the Holy Quran to serve as a tale of the past. In fact, God Almighty was extremely pleased with this prayer and preserved this prayer so that in future, mothers will continue to offer such extraordinary sacrifices by devoting their children for the service of faith while reciting this prayer. Though every mu'min, i.e. a believer, makes the pledge to give precedence to his or her faith over worldly affairs, but those who dedicate their lives should become those who reach the extreme heights of such standards that have been set. Therefore, when mothers and fathers will instill in the children's mind that they are waqf, I have devoted their life, and that they have been dedicated solely to serve the faith, and that alone is the purpose of their life, and along with this, they will be praying for them, then children will grow up with this thought that they are to serve the faith. and they will not grow up thinking that they want to become a businessman or a sports player, or they want to go into such and such field. Rather, they will ask the question that I am Waqf-e-Nau, and now the Jamaat and the Khalifa of the time should tell me which field I should choose to go in, as I no longer have any interest in worldly pursuits. Also, the pledge which my mother made before my birth, and the prayers that she made before my birth, and then the manner in which she brought me up, so that I should pursue faith instead of worldly things. It is now my good fortune that those prayers have been heard by God Almighty, and the efforts of my mother, which she made for my upbringing, have been made fruitful by Allah the Almighty. And now, without any greed for worldly things, and solely with the desire of serving my faith, I dedicate my life. Now, it is essential that this thought should be first expressed by the Waqf-e-Nau when they renew their bond of Waqf at the age of 15. And for this, I have also instructed the relevant departments that they should formally obtain this in writing from all those who are at the age of 15, that whether or not they want to continue with their Waqf. Then, after the age of 20, 21, when they have completed their studies, and if they have not entered Jamia, they should write again to renew their bond. And if someone is told to gain further training in any particular field, then again they should write after its completion. In other words, a Waqf-e-Nau should himself express his desire of continuing with his Waqf at every stage. As I mentioned earlier, that I have spoken about this subject previously on many occasions and in great detail. No Waqf-e-Nau child should ever have this thought that if he dedicates his life, then how shall he fare by worldly standards? Or to allow this apprehension to develop in his heart of how he will manage to financially support his parents, or even to support them by any other means. A few days ago, the Waqf-e-Nau had a class with me, and one of the boys asked the question that if they dedicate their lives and offer all their services to the Jamaat, then how can they financially or physically support their parents, or even generally offer any kind of support to them? The very fact that this question arose reveals that parents have not instilled this idea in their children's hearts from a young age, that they have dedicated their lives and that now they are simply a trust of the Jamaat that has been placed in the care of the parents. The other siblings will serve them, but he must present himself to the Khalifa of the time and will act according to the instructions of the Khalifa. The word Muharraran, which has been used in the prayer of Hazrat Maryam's mother, means that this child has been divorced from all worldly affairs. And now it is my prayer that he or she shall purely give preference to faith. Therefore, first and foremost, I would like to say to the mothers and fathers that a mere title of Waqf-e-Nu is not enough. In fact, Waqf, i.e. life devotion, carries a great responsibility, which until the adolescent years lies with the parents. But then, after that, it is the responsibility of the Waqf-e-Nu itself. Some boys and girls who have acquired secular education appear to show a lot of passion and offer their services. However, some cases have come to light where some have left because they could not manage within the allowance that Jamaat gave them. However, one has to encounter difficulties and make sacrifices if one wants to achieve a great objective. Thus, this concept should be ingrained in the minds of the Waqf-e-Nu from childhood, that there is nothing greater than devoting one's life. And instead of looking at others by worldly measures and thinking that such and such class fellow of mine has acquired the same amount of education as me, yet he is earning in thousands, while my monthly income does not even come near to what he earns in one day. Rather, one's thinking should be that the status God Almighty has granted me is far better than any worldly material. One should always keep the saying of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before them, that in regards to worldly material and means, one should always look at those who are less fortunate than him. And in regards to spirituality, one should always look at those who are better than him. So that instead of competing with one another in worldly gains, one should vie with one another in matters of spirituality. Thus, those Waqf-e-Nu children, particularly the boys who have completed their studies, they should try to improve their spiritual conditions instead of their material and financial conditions. In fact, the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, expects this from every Ahmadi, that their standards in this regard should be very high. However, those individuals whose parents have dedicated them for the service of faith, even before their birth, and have prayed for them, how much of an effort should they then have to make in order to attain these standards? The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, states, I consider it my duty to advise my Jamaat and convey this message to them. Thereafter, it is their choice of whether they pay heed to it or not. That is, that if one seeks salvation and a pure and eternal life, then one should devote his life for the sake of Allah the Almighty. And each and every one of you must make an effort for this and deliberate over this so that one can attain such a rank and position whereby one can say that his life, his death, his sacrifices and his prayers are for Allah alone. And just like Hazrat Ibrahim, his soul should cry out. That is, that I have already submitted to the Lord of the worlds. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, further states, until man does not lose himself in God and does not die whilst he is at one with God, he cannot attain the true meaning of life. Thus, those of you who have forged a relationship with me, you would know that by dedicating one's life for God Almighty is the essence and aim of this life. In other words, this is the aim and objective of one's life. Also, analyze yourself, that how many from among you would desire this for themselves, in that dedicating their lives for God would be dear to them. Thus, the Waqf-e-Nu should understand this principle and raise their own status above this. Others also dedicate their lives for the service of their faith. But at the same time, not everyone can dedicate their lives. God has also stated that a party from among you should go in search of religious knowledge and return and enlighten their own people. Also, some people are engrossed in their worldly pursuits. However, the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has stated that even in your workplaces, you should have the fear of God in your mind and ensure your faith takes precedence. The Waqfineno must raise their levels of contentment and also their levels of sacrifices. They should never worry that if we are not strong financially, then perhaps our brothers and sisters may consider us inferior, or that our parents may not give us the same attention they give to others. Firstly, parents should never entertain the belief that life devotees are inferior in any way. The status and rank of a life devotee is extraordinary, or at least it should be in their view. However, the devotees of life should become the most humble person on earth. Whilst the Waqfineno should raise their levels of sacrifice, at the same time, they must raise the level of their worship and raise their level of loyalty. They should use all of their abilities and capacities to fulfill the covenant and the oath of their parents. They should endeavor to serve their faith and make every effort for the elevation of their faith. In such a case, God Almighty rewards abundantly and does not continue without granting reward. In regards to fulfilling one's covenant with sincerity, on one occasion the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam stated, "For this very reason, God Almighty praised Hazrat Ibrahim in the Holy Quran, where it states, that is, that Ibrahim was one who fulfilled the covenant he made. Thus, fulfilling the oaths one makes is not a small matter. The covenants made by those devotees of life, about which I read the heart-rending words of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, are in fact grand covenants. And if every Waqfino boy and girl fulfill their pledges with sincerity, then we can bring about a revolution in the world. Many young couples come to see me, and the boy says that he is Waqfino, as is his wife and child. Or the mother will say that she is Waqfino, or the father will say he is Waqfino, and my child is also Waqfino. Indeed, this is a matter of great repute. However, it will only be beneficial for the Jamaat when they fulfill their pledges with the utmost loyalty. Whilst commenting on the loyalty shown by Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam explained the topic in the following manner. The promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam states, "In order to attain the nearness of God Almighty, one must adhere to truthfulness and become steadfast upon it. You must form a sincere connection with God Almighty. The nearness which Hazrat Ibrahim gained was due to this very reason. That is why God stated, that is, that Ibrahim was the one who showed loyalty. Sincerity with God Almighty and maintaining loyalty with Him requires a death upon oneself. And until man is prepared to shun the world with all of its attractions and incentives and undergo every type of humiliation, difficulty and struggle, until then, this attribute cannot be developed. Idol worship is not only that one prostrates before a tree or a stone. Rather, everything that prevents one from gaining nearness to God Almighty or takes precedence over it is an idol. And man forms so many idols within him that he is not even aware that he is committing idolatry. In this day and age, for some people, drama serials have become idols. And for some, the internet has become an idol. For some, earning money has become an idol. And for some, their own desires have become their idols. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has stated, "Man does not even know he is committing idolatry, yet deep within he becomes a culprit of it. Thus, until man becomes one with God Almighty sincerely, and is prepared to endure every type of struggle, it will be difficult to adopt truthfulness and loyalty." The title awarded to Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, the promised Messiah continues to say, was the title awarded to Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam given for no reason? Absolutely not. The sound that Ibrahim alladhi wafa, Ibrahim is the one who fulfilled the covenant, resonated the instant he prepared himself to sacrifice his son. God Almighty demands physical deeds, and it is through deeds that he is pleased. And deeds can only be performed through striving. This means that in order to carry out virtuous deeds and to perform those deeds which would please God, one must offer sacrifices and endure various difficulties and pains. The promised Messiah alayhi salam continues by saying, although man may face difficulty in carrying out virtuous deeds, but he does not remain in pain forever. When man accepts to endure pain for the sake of God Almighty, then God does not allow him to stay in pain. When Ibrahim alayhi salam accepted to sacrifice his son in order to fulfill the commandment of God Almighty, and the minute he prepared everything, then God Almighty saved his son. The life of the son was spared, and he was also saved from this pain he would have suffered from sacrificing his son. The promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam further adds, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown into the fire, yet the fire could not harm him. If one is prepared to endure pain for the sake of God Almighty, the promised Messiah states, if man prepares himself to endure pain for the sake of God Almighty, then God Almighty himself saves him from that pain. Thus, this is the standard for absorbing the love of God Almighty and beseeching His grace that the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has explained to us and has expected from each and every one of us. Not only should all waqfinano endeavor to achieve this standard, but all those who have devoted their lives should do this as well. Until their sacrifices reach such a level, all the claims of our life devotees will only be superficial and mere statements. Some mothers say that we have come to settle in Canada, and our son is a missionary and life devotee serving in Pakistan, and that we request for you to assign him here and call him here, so he may be with us. However, when one has dedicated their life, then how can there be any demands and desires? All desires should have come to an end. As I mentioned earlier, that the trend to include children into the Waqf-e-Nau scheme is growing, and this is excellent. However, this trend should increase in a matter that we are sincerely turning towards Allah the Almighty, And it should not be the case that with the changing of situations, our covenants weaken or break. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, stated, without enduring pain or without difficulty, it is not possible to offer true sacrifice. If the circumstances have changed, then we must endure it, especially those who have presented themselves for the service of faith, or those parents who have dedicated their children and then have renewed their promises, stating that they would like to continue with their pledge. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, states, when man is prepared to offer every kind of sacrifice for the sake of God, then God Almighty rewards him and does not hold anything back, and rewards him abundantly. May God Almighty enable the Waqfineno and their parents to fulfill their pledges while keeping the true essence of sacrifice in mind, and may they raise their standards of loyalty and sincerity to ever-increasing new heights. I will now briefly explain some administrative matters and would like to draw the attention to the guidelines for the Waqfin. Often people ask various questions, and some Waqfineno have certain misconceptions that since they are Waqfino, i.e. life devotees, they have their own separate identity. And although they may have a separate identity, however, they should not expect any kind of special treatment. In fact, given their separate identity, they must ensure that they raise their level of sacrifice. Some people embed in the minds of young Waqfino children that they are very special, and consequently when they grow up, all that is in their minds is that they are merely special. I have received this question as well as other questions of this nature. These hinder one from the true essence of devotion, and they think that the mere title of being a Waqfino as their sole purpose in life, and consider that they are special. Some have this in mind, that since they are Waqfino, therefore they do not need to attend any Nasirat or Lajna programs, if they are girls. And similarly, they think that they do not need to attend any Khuddam and Atfal programs, if they are boys. And thinking that their organization has become separate. If someone deep down has this concept, then this is completely wrong. Every office bearer of the Jamaat, to the extent that even the Amir, i.e. the head of the country, is a member of the respective auxiliary organization relevant to their age. Thus, every Waqfino girl and boy should remember that they are members of their respective auxiliary organization within their corresponding age groups. And whichever age group they fall under, it is compulsory for them to take part in their respective programs. For those who do not participate, the head of that respective administration should investigate the matter and report accordingly. And if that Waqfino does not rectify themselves, then such a child, boy or youth, will be removed from the Waqfino scheme. If, however, there are certain functions of the Jamaat, or there are programs for auxiliary organizations or Waqfino programs, then they should collaborate to ascertain a time which does not clash with the programs of auxiliary organizations or the Waqfino programs. Thus, one should be particularly mindful of this matter. Waqfino children, as I mentioned, are very special. However, in order to be regarded as special, they will have to prove certain things. What are those things that they will have to prove? They will have to prove that they have a stronger relationship with Allah the Almighty in order to be considered special. They will be called special if they have a greater fear of God than others. They will be called special if their standards of worship are much higher than those of others. They will be called special if they, in addition to the compulsory prayers, also offer voluntary prayers, i.e. nawafil. They will be called special if they have a greater fear of God than others. And another sign of their being special would be that their general morals are of the highest standard. They will be called special if their conversations and general speech are very distinct from those of others, and if it is clearly evident that they have been specially trained and are among those who give precedence to faith over the world in every situation. In case of girls, they will be considered special if their attire and their parda are such an example of true Islamic teachings that when others see them, they envy them and say that indeed, despite living in this society, their attire and parda are extraordinarily exemplary. In the case of boys, they will be considered special if they lower their gaze due to modesty, instead of wandering their eyes here and there, looking at improper things. They will be considered special if instead of looking at immoral things on the internet or through other means, they utilize their time in acquiring religious knowledge. They will be considered special if their appearances make them look distinct from others. Vakfeno boys and girls will be considered special if they regularly recite the Holy Quran and search for its commandments and then act upon them. They will be considered special if they participate in events organized by the Jamaat or its auxiliary organizations more actively and regularly than other people. If they are leading their siblings in the good treatment of parents and in supplicating for them, then this is also a distinction. They will be called special if boys as well as girls are such that they focus on faith instead of worldly matters when it comes to finding matches for marriages and also maintain those marriages later on. If that is the case, only then can they claim to sustain their relationships while truly following religious guidelines. If they have the capacity to endure more than others, if they protect themselves from arguments or strife, and instead tend to resolve such matters, then they will be considered special. They will be considered special if in the field of preaching they are at the forefront in fulfilling their duty. And they will be considered special if they are at the forefront in the obedience to Khilafat and in following its instructions. If they are of a resilient character and willing to make sacrifices, then they are certainly special. If they display humility and a spirit of selflessness more than others, and despise arrogance and strive against it, then indeed they are special. If they listen to my Friday sermons and watch every program of mine on MTA, in order to continually attain guidance, then they are very special. If they act upon these things, and upon all those things which please Allah the Almighty, and they refrain from what displeases Him and what He has forbidden, then they are certainly special, or rather very special. Otherwise, there is no difference between you and others. Parents should also remember these matters and raise their children in this manner. If you inhibit these characteristics, then Allah the Almighty has made you a means for revolution in this day and age. However, if this is not the case, and consequently you are not a role model for the world, then let alone special, you would in fact be counted among the disloyal and the treacherous before Allah the Almighty due to not fulfilling your covenants or upholding your standards of loyalty. Thus, during the upbringing, it is the parents' responsibility to make them special in this regard, so that these waqfin-e-no are able to reach these standards of being special once they are grown up. As I mentioned earlier, during the religious and secular education, and whilst passing through different stages, they should consult the Jamaat regarding what field they should study in, rather than taking these decisions for themselves. In regards to the selection of a career path, I have mentioned this before, that the Waqfine boys should prioritize enrolling in the various Jamiats and becoming missionaries. There is a need for this at this time. The Jamaat is growing by the grace of Allah the Almighty, and not only are there new local Jamaats being established in these countries where the Ahmadiyya Jamaat has been long established, but Allah the Almighty is also granting us new countries where new local Jamaats are being created. Therefore, we require countless missionaries in every country. Additionally, there is a need for doctors at our hospitals. Many doctors who are specialists in various fields are needed in Rabwan, Pakistan. Doctors are also needed at the hospital in Qadian. Even if those from Western countries cannot be sent there, my sermon is being heard all over the world, and so the attention of Waqfin-e-no in your respective countries should be drawn towards this. There is a huge gap as we lack specialist doctors. There is a need for doctors in virtually every field of expertise in Africa. Currently, the construction of a large hospital is underway in Guatemala, to which even doctors from Canada could go. There is a need for doctors there, which is going to increase in the future. There is a need for doctors in Indonesia, and as the Jamaat grows, this need will keep growing as well. Thus, those Waqfin-e-no children who are training to become doctors, after having completed their higher education in these countries and having undertaken their specialization and having gained experience, should come forward and they should go to the countries where it might be easier for them to go to. Or rather, they should present themselves and the Jamaat will undertake their stationing. In the same way, we need teachers. For doctors and teachers, we need both men and women. Therefore, give due consideration to these professions. We also need architects and engineers who can specialize in construction so that they can accurately supervise and plan the construction of our mosques, mission houses, schools, hospitals, and other building projects. This will help save the funds of the community, and we will be able to provide better services for less expenditure. Then we also need paramedical staff, and the Waqfin-e-no should select this profession too. So these are some of the important areas for which our community needs manpower. In the future, these needs might change according to the demand of the time. Sometimes, Waqfin-e-no have a special aptitude to certain subjects, and so when they ask me, I approve that they can pursue further education in their chosen fields. However, I will say this to all students, that they should accomplish research in different fields of science. And this instruction is for all Waqfin-e-no and other students alike. If we nurture the best scientists in our community, then Ahmadis will not only be the voice of religious teachings, which the world will rely on to learn about religion, but Ahmadis will also become the leaders of the worldly knowledge, and the world will depend on them to attain knowledge. based on this principle. Indeed, Waqfin-e Nau can work for worldly organizations, but the objective of their knowledge and skill will have to be to prove the unity of God and to spread the true teachings of the faith in this world. In the same way, the Waqfin-e Nau can choose to go into other fields, but they must appreciate their fundamental objective, that they have dedicated their lives for the service of their religion. Therefore, if summoned at any time to give up their worldly commitments, to commence their service for their faith, then they should show up without any excuses or delays. Another important point that every Waqfin-e Nau must remember is that when they are given permission to work, these responsibilities should not deprive them of the blessed tasks of worship of God and the acquisition of religious knowledge and serving their faith. However, their first and foremost priority should be to attain the highest standards in these faith-related matters. It is absolutely mandatory for every Waqfin-e Nau to study the commentary of the Holy Quran and the books of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam. I understand that the Department of Waqfin-e Nau has designed a syllabus for them until the age of 21. That is available for you. On top of that, it is absolutely essential that you make an effort to deepen and widen your religious knowledge. I would also like to emphasize this to the parents, that they can try to do the moral training of their children with all their efforts. But if this is only verbal effort, then this training will have no impact whatsoever. Their words and actions have to be concordant. Parents have to be a role model for their children in the way they offer Salat, and will have to set the highest practical examples of how to learn and teach the Holy Quran. Parents will have to become the practical role models of excellent morals. Parents will have to make a concerted effort to gain religious knowledge, and they will have to clearly demonstrate with their religious knowledge. They will also have to clearly demonstrate with their examples that they are repulsed by falsehood. And they will have to absolutely refrain from saying anything derogatory about the system and the office holders of the community, even if they are hurt by an office holder. Parents will have to demonstrate that they regularly listen to the MTA, at the minimum my sermons. All these directives are not just for the parents of the Waqfin-e Nau, indeed all Ahmadis who want their progeny remains connected to the community, must make every effort to make their homes as Ahmadi households instead of worldly homes. Otherwise, their next generations would move away from Ahmadiyya in the pursuit of this world. And worse still, they would move away from God and would face ruin in this world and the hereafter. May God Almighty make it happen that all Waqfin-e Nau children seek the nearness to Allah the Almighty and follow the path of God-fearing righteousness. May the actions of their loved ones save them from any embarrassment. Instead, every Ahmadi becomes the true Ahmadi, as repeatedly directed by the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, so that we can see the flag of Ahmadiyya and true Islam flying high. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, advised us by saying, "A person assumes that I have pleased my God by doing merely one or two tasks, while that is not the case." The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, states, "It is extremely difficult to show obedience. The true obedience was demonstrated by the companions of the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. These are the standards of true obedience that are the role models for us." The promised Messiah further states, "Is obedience an easy matter? Anyone who does not show complete obedience brings disrepute to this community. There is not just one commandment, there are many commandments. There are many doors to paradise, and people attain the capability to enter paradise through different doors. In the same way, there are many doors to hell. You do not want to be in a position where you close one door to hell but leave the other one open." Then the promised Messiah says, "After taking the oath of allegiance, One must not remain under the misconception that merely believing that Ahmadiyyat is a true movement would lead to all the blessings. Simply accepting the truthfulness of this movement is not going to please Allah the Exalted until your deeds become good. Now that you have entered this community, you must try to become pious and refrain from all evil. Use gentle and pious speech. Make it your routine to offer repentance for your sins and supplicate in your salat. May Allah the Exalted enable us to act on this advice. May we and our progeny set the highest standard in piety and God-fearing righteousness and accomplish the mission of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh wa na'uzu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وَادْعُوهُ يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ